Guys, thank you so much for joining another episode from Herbalize. Now, today I got a special guest, Mr. James Anderson. How's everything going, James?
Good, Eli. Thanks for having me on the show.
Awesome, awesome. And for those who don't know you, James, you might as well give us a little bit of background on yourself.
Yeah, sure. I've been in the bullion industry for just over a dozen years. I got in it because, you know, I personally was investing in it for so long, I figured it was time to actually start working in the industry. And so yeah, I've been it for a while, and SD Bullion I've been at since 2017. And So my experience is pretty broad and pretty deep. And, you know, I always thought we'd see another fall 2008 scenario. I just didn't know exactly how it would come about. And this, we're getting there. In terms of silver, we are there. In terms of gold, we're almost there.
Gotcha. Yeah, man, it's been a crazy couple of months, man. Everybody's been affected by it. I'm home, and obviously you're home. Yeah. You know, so utilizing self-quarantine. Well, you know, speaking about gold and silver, one thing as a stacker, and multiple stackers out here watching my channel wants to know this question, so we can always speculate what's going on with the bullion dealers. But in your perspective, what's really going on? Because the premiums are a bit high, and silver's being sold out, so we can't even buy it even at these high premiums. What's your thoughts on that?
So I'm going to go back real quickly to the fall 2008. I wrote an article when I first got to SD Bullion because the people there, they weren't even working in the industry. You know, they started the company in 2012. So I felt like the old grizzled veteran having to come in and be like, yo, you got to get ready for this. You know, I was warning a lot of people about this. This is coming. They may have thought I was Chicken Little, but it's here now. So, but in the fall of 2008, we had spot. For those that are out there who don't know this, but spot went from 21 in the spring of 2008 all the way down to 9 in September, or 9 by like December. So it wasn't like as fast as this one. This one from 19 to 12 was like a couple days. It was one of the fastest drops ever. But in that decline, we had a situation because banks were, you know, essentially bankrupting. We had almost 30 banks in the United States go under, and then around the world there was others. And so people were literally like, get me the hell out of my bank, get me into gold, get me into silver. Phone wouldn't stop ringing off the hook. You had a situation where everything on the shelves was gonzo. And then you're trying to source product, but there's nothing there, or you're sourcing product and like, we can deliver it in 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks, you know, that type of stuff. And we're not going to take any more orders because we don't want the blowback. People asking us when it's coming, a week later, 2 weeks later, jamming up our lines. We're trying to get more orders coming through and other products we're selling. So I think it's a misconception of how the industry works. We don't do a really good job of explaining it because there's a lot of fear that, you know, retail dealers will get jumped and they'll run to a wholesale dealer. And it's ridiculous because if anyone out there trying to call a wholesale desk, they don't know you, they're just going to hang the phone up on you. They're not going to deal with you. They only deal with dealers because they won't work with retail customers, because the retail customer will buy at 19, the price will drop at 12, and the retail customer will walk away. And they don't play that game. You know, you show yourself to be not proper and actually executing trades always, then you're not as good as your word, and you'll never get to do business with them again. So it's no joke. You don't play that. So the spreads there, they ran from 9 spot. They were peaking up to like 17, 18. Of course, there was people on eBay selling for 25, 30, whatever. And that, you know, you could go back in the Wayback Machine and see that. On the gold side, you had spot hitting the high 600s. You had Gold Eagle selling at 1,000. So, you know, I saw that. I went through that. It was difficult, but it was a great time for bullion dealers too, because in that spread, you can make pretty good profits. And the reason, you know, those are the moments as a bullion dealer where you have to take advantage, because there's years that go by where you make dimes on like massive trades. You make nothing. You're just making those trades essentially to box out your competition, because there's thousands of these dealers out there, right? And they're all selling the same damn thing. So how are you going to differentiate yourself? Price, you know, service, being honest, being, you know, delivering on their word, etc. So that's, I think, the issue is all the layers too, right? Think from, you have miners to refiners to mints, dealers, and then all of a sudden there's this huge influx that come in, and then you're a dealer. All you have is to do is sell bullion. You don't have anything else to sell. So if your product's off the shelf and you got no chance to even sell anything forward, you got nothing. You're gonna have to start firing and laying off people right at the moment when you need those people to ship the stuff out the door. You're hiring more people to ship stuff out the door. So it gets very complex. And not to say that these aren't great times for dealers. These are some of the best times for dealers because they're getting so much demand and the volume of sales is huge. But it makes it very difficult because you're not ready for that type of volume. You're just not. And so you have to be flexible. You have to be ready to work 20-hour days. That kind of stuff happens. So, right now, the situation, it's really bad. And I don't think it's going to turn around anytime soon, given circumstances with the viral issue. So what's coming in the future? I you have a situation right now where even on the gold side in London, there's issues with really large gold orders from central banks, from funds, mutual funds, like ETFs, et cetera. I mean, those people, they're not at their desk working, they're at home. And then the people who pick, pack, and ship and who move things logistically around, they're not working. So how are you gonna source metal? And there's companies out there, right, that are screaming for metal, they can't get it. it's a very, very difficult situation all the way from the central bank level all the way down to the retail level. So if people are out there who want to do more digging into this, understand a little bit deeper how silver works, look up how the silver price is determined, SD Bullion. Just look that up in your Google search. I wrote it in April of 2018. You can dig into that and it'll teach you a lot of things about kind of how it operates. I've written a lot of articles on my website trying to explain to people, because it's just, when you have ignorance, then you have people just spouting off at the mouth with conspiracy theories and stuff. It just don't make any sense. And how are you going to talk down a crowd of a bunch of people just, there's like 1,000 of them out there saying nonsense. So it's difficult sometimes to even, because you're just one person, your voice is so small. So I find it a little frustrating, but I'm sure they find it frustrating too. You come to our website, spots at 12, prices at 20. Oh man, you're going to be angry. I get it.
Yeah, makes sense. I was one of them. I was one of the persons probably saying nonsense, but that's why I reached out to you, because especially with your background, I'm like, hey, I want to get information straight from the source. So even just by listening to you talk, I've learned so much and have a deeper understanding on what's going on, especially as far as the bullion dealers.
Okay.
Now you briefly talked about when silver plunged down like close to 60% in 2008-2007, and we did see in 2011 we saw a surge. Do you possibly see another scenario where that happens within the next maybe 2 to 3 years, or even in this year?
So when you look back at the charts, you see the chart of gold and silver, like right when they announced quantitative easing one, there was a big panic and fear that was going to end up becoming very inflationary. And hyperinflationary was the real worry. It's like, oh God, these guys don't know what they're doing. They're gonna somehow that there's a velocity of currency is gonna pick up and we're gonna have really runaway inflation. That did not happen. We did get a lot of inflation in a lot of places. It melted out in weird ways. We had an inflation in the stock market. We have inflation in healthcare. We have inflation in higher education. We have inflation in housing. We have inflation in good, decent food, not crap food, but good food that's not subsidized. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of inflation that's happened, and they lie to us every year, compounding. Every year they lie to us about 5-7%, really, what the true inflation rate is. Everybody knows that. Mm-hmm. So right now we have a situation where the bailout's going to get even larger than the one that we saw in 2008. It's going to be much larger. They're talking about $6 trillion. When they started talking in 2008, they started with $700 billion, and they brought cash carry out, this clown, who was essentially an intern from Goldman Sachs, who tagged along with Hank Paulson, and he was sitting there and with a bold face saying like, no problem, $700 billion. And then just all of a sudden balloon and mushroom. 2 years later, partial audit with the Federal Reserve, you find out we loaned and backstopped $29 trillion in loans. So that's 41 times what the initial amount was. If you're at $6 trillion right now and you do a 40 bagger on that, you're backstopping the entire global debt supply. The total global debt supply is roughly $250 trillion, okay? Mm-hmm. So essentially the Federal Reserve is saying, we will buy anything and everything and you get US dollars. Everything's backed by us. And they don't have anything in their bank account. They just have their word and our military and the tax slaves essentially that live in the country. So, that's all they got essentially. And a system that's been captured by the financial industry. They have a lot of power because the US dollar, the financial industry, it's very powerful. There's no rival. I mean, the euro, it's not even close. What happened? What came out of it? Silver was at 9, gold was at 700 roughly. In two and a half years to 3 years, it ran from $9 silver up to $50. And you had gold run from roughly 700 all the way up to 1900. And this time will be no different at my expectation. I think you're going to see Silver run at least a five bagger. I mean, I'm very confident that we're going beyond 50. And once we go beyond 50, 50 becomes support. And then you end up going toward triple digits. Gold, I mean, gold, if it's not, unless we have just an incredible deflationary crash, which doesn't look like it's going to happen because they're out there ready to pump, you know, fiat Fed notes into virtually anything and everything. So my hunch is what they're going to be doing and what they kind of have to, because they've been promising all these things they can't deliver on. The only way to promise and deliver on it nominally is to debase the hell out of the currency by 75-80%. It's similar to, like, go back and look at your history, like 1933. They told everybody, hey, bring in your gold. You're not allowed to have more than 3, 4, 5 ounces of gold. The rest of it, bring in. And here's $20.67 on face paper. And then just a few months later, we'll sign a little thing and $35 an ounce. That'll do it. That wasn't enough. They should have gone to 70. The Great Depression lasted longer because it was deflationary price. It should have been higher. Mm-hmm. So this time, you know, what's the number? Let's think, 5,000, that's not enough. You're gonna have to go to probably 10 or higher to get the inflation that they need. So this idea, like, the $2,000 gold's expensive, yeah, it's not expensive. That's gonna be support. I mean, if you think Bitcoin at 17 makes sense, you better damn well be thinking gold's gonna be around, you know, making sense at 10 grand. I mean, that stuff's not going away. You know, that stuff's made by star explosions. You know, that's the human fallibility is human fallibility, but gold is gold, and everybody in the world knows that. And so they go for it in trying times. So my expectation is the outcome of this is going to be explosive for precious metals.
Okay. So even with the high premiums, would you recommend someone who's new to still, or even older stackers like myself, would you still your recommendation still say, hey, buy silver as much as you can get right now? Would that be a recommendation?
It really depends where your position is. If you're an older stacker, how large a position? Is it prudent? Like, a prudent position in bullion at these days, if you start backtracking the data, 20-25%. That's about as much as you should put into bullion, okay? You go any longer than that, it's a little bit aggressive. You know, you may go too far, overextend yourself, have to wait too long, get angry, et cetera, start lashing out at people thinking that it was their responsibility, all right? You gotta be prudent about this. But most people in the world have absolutely no bullion. So there's a lot of people here who probably are like, damn, I missed out. I wanted to get involved in this. Well, you can. The question is how you do it. And, you know, you have to be intelligent. You go around and try and get it as close to spot as you possibly can. If Silver Eagles come back to Earth, you may want to get some Silver Eagles, because as you can see, they have this really interesting spot where you buy them and you can arbitrage them. Like, for instance, I sold a case of Silver Eagles just recently, because when the premiums gap out like this, you gotta take advantage. You sell the Silver Eagles and you go buy the lower, cheaper stuff, and all of a sudden you get 200 free ounces. You know, so it's like, that's an easy arbitrage play, as long as the counterparties you're dealing with are legit. And there's no, you gotta be careful with that, because your counterparties, if they're fraudulent or some issue comes up with the payments, et cetera, you gotta know what you're doing. But there's plays in there all the time. I mean, Silver Eagles, Gold Eagles, they're the ones that explode in premium. And so if you can get some, it's good, because there are times like these when they're in high demand and there's a lot of people willing to pay through the eye to get them. And so having a diversification, you know, don't go all Silver Eagles, maybe go half or a third of your stack of Silver Eagles. And then you got other things, you know, for the larger amount of ounces, et cetera. So I hope that answers the question. I mean,
learned a lot.
I mean, the question is this: look, we may be in a situation where it runaway trains, where it goes to a situation where these fake prices that you get seen every day on the spot market and the ETFs and the LBMA and whatever they tell you that the price is, well, that may be the price for if you're in their paper derivative market and you can get someone in that paper derivative market to agree that that's a legitimate price and deliver you 100 ounce, gold bars, 400 ounce gold bars, kilo gold bars at that price, or you can deliver 1,000 ounce, manufacturing silver bars at that price. That may or may not happen. For most retail buyers, you know, there's a bottleneck there, because you have to have a refiner and a manufacturer create the product, and then it has to move down the chain. And if this demand doesn't subside, you may have a situation where it just kind of runs away, and you get a situation where the prices start diverging. So I wouldn't, if you don't have any, get something, and then kind of bide your time. Don't go all in. Slowly but surely start doing it. The prices probably will be creeping up. I don't know if we'll have a double dip. We may. You know, mm-hmm. we still may have a double dip where it goes down further. Could go below 1190 or whatever the low was recently. So that's why you just kind of bide your time, do it slowly and surely and wisely. So I hope people understand that. Yeah.
Yeah, it makes sense, man. Learned a lot from that just itself. Now, sure. just wanted to get your opinion. Based off everything that's going on in the economy today, do you feel like there's a recovery point, or are we at a point where we can't return, or is there any, like, we can still recover from what's going on? What's your thoughts?
Well, there's a lot of people out there who are like, you watch a mania, like, for instance, the stock market mania we just kind of saw crash. Mm-hmm. And in a crash like that, the people who were, like, so gung-ho about the stock market, like, yeah, MAGA, yeah, look at the stock market go. In this little crash now, we're down a speed faster than 1929. You know, 1929 is no joke. That's not a place you want to be in a stock market, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But there are people out there who look at the mechanics of it, and they look at the potentiality of it re-ramping. And I don't necessarily think that's true. I have my doubts. I pretty much told people that's canceled to their face. Mm-hmm. You know, some people think that may happen next year or two. I personally have my doubts. What I think's going to happen is we're going to have a little bit of a blip for some time here, and then we're going to see slowly but surely death by 10,000 cuts on the way down as this thing value-wise starts losing value to gold first, foremost, and then to other real things. People are going to start seeing, like, hey, there's not that much value in the stock market. Baby boomers are too scared to go back in it. They just got their face ripped off, and the little retirement they have left, they're probably going to be, you know what, I think I'll go somewhere safer. You know, I'll probably take it out and put it somewhere else. So my bet is, no, that's not going to happen. I don't think we're going to see a re-ramp in the stock market unless we have some crazy inflation and we turn into Venezuela. I don't see that. I think that this was the peak in terms of, you know, this latest bubble in stocks and basically everything. I mean, if you look around, like the bond bubble, it looks like it could be bursting too. You have a situation where the 10-year yield is like gyrating up and down at like ridiculous volatilities in one of the most supposedly stable asset classes. This is a different thing that we're dealing with now. So people have to be ready and flexible. And look, the last 50 years are not going to look like the next 50. Okay, just stop using the last 50 as like, you know, we're not in a cycle where we're just building up debt. We're now in a cycle where it's questionable as whose debt's what, who's going to actually pay it, and how they're going to do it. Are they going to default on it? Are they going to debase through it? How are they going to do that? And what's that going to do to confidence? You know, and so ultimately, I think we're headed toward later this decade into the next, a commodity melt up, because in commodities, generally gold leads a commodity melt up. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, at some point you have low prices forever. They beget people not doing anything, people not digging the stuff out. And then in order to get them to go and dig it out of the ground and make the real things, they have to jack the prices up real high. And so, you know, you have to bid it up higher. So essentially, you go from a stock bubble to a commodity bubble is what you end up seeing a lot of times in history. So that's my belief. And I just think that they have to debase the currency. The federal government is well over. And federal government, combine it with all the pension funds and all these other people that have promised things that they're not going to be able to deliver on. In order to do that, you're going to at least have a fiat inflation. So maybe the stock market nominally could look nice, you know, but it's not going to buy you as much in gold in real value. That's the big deal. Right now, the gold Dow ratio or the gold S&P ratio, look at that and see what it went to in 1980 and start thinking about it. Is that potentially where it's going toward the end of this decade into next? You know, start thinking about, would I rather own what?
Gotcha. Okay. Makes sense. Well, James, it's always a pleasure to have you on here. Thank you so much for your time today.
Sure.
That's pretty much it, guys. Make sure you guys hit that subscribe button and also check James' blogs on SD Bullion tab resources. I always go on there. Make sure you guys check that out.
Don't forget to hit the thumbs up button. And also don't forget to check out my the videos I make every week on SD Bullion's YouTube channel. Check those out too.
Awesome. All the links are going to be down in the description below, guys. Have a beautiful day.